Hi there, and welcome to this, the 11th video in the SPT framework series. In this video, we're going to cover off the event logger system. So we're going to have a short video just describing the event logger to give us some background on what we did in the previous two videos of tracing and what we're going to do going forward with our event creation for our components. Let's get started. Okay, so simply put, the TwinCAT 3 event logger is a piece of software that has a bit of memory that lives in the TwinCAT system. So we can then pass event messages from the runtime environment up to this cache memory, and this can then be accessed from various components. We saw in the previous two videos with tracing that we could access it via the XAE environments, the engineering environment for debugging and checking purposes. We can also access via HMI. There's already a NuGet package you can download to bring an event logger into your HMI that will automatically connect to the event logger and display those events. And there are other ways you can access it via third-party applications we will come on to later. Now, the event logger is structured in such a way that it uses what it refers to as event classes. Okay, so it's effectively, as we've learned from object-oriented programming, a base class that's called the event class. And we then derive two child objects from that. The first is a message and the second is an alarm. Now the message is what we've actually been using in the trace. If we go back to our project and have a quick look into the SPT framework library, under the tracing folder, if you remember, we have our FB trace log, and you'll see the base object inside that is one of these messages. Okay, so the tracing function that we use is actually this derived object called a message, and it just sits there in that FB trace log instance in the global variable list. So when you type in trace, it just sends via that, and you can see it only has a single function, send. If we go back into the actual execution of the code itself, looking inside the actual call, you'll notice at the bottom here there's a lot of stuff going on to tidy up the message and to make it compatible, but the event actually just has an event.send method call, which is that usage at the bottom there. Okay, and these events can be used in a number of ways. You can see here we have obviously a cache, and below the event logger where obviously all of it's stored, we have some event definitions, and we'll come back to that in later videos, how we actually define events. We'll do an entire video on that. But the access can then be achieved via HMI. So there is a server extension to the HMI which allows you to drag the events out onto your TwinCAT HMI or via browser. We've obviously got an ADS route so that you can pull the events out to via ADS itself into your own HMI if that's the way you wanted to actually develop it, or to your own storage system if you were actually gathering data that way. And finally, we can access it via the log window, which is what we were using in the previous two videos to actually check the results of our tracing. So if you remember, when we called the reset counter, we got the trace message saying that it started, and when we called the or pulsed the success failed boolean flags, we got another message showing us whether it passed or failed the operation. Okay, so that's the message side of things. Now, importantly for us going forward in the video series is the alarm side. You can see on the right hand side, the derived child object of the event is the alarm, and it has a number of different options. So we can raise an alarm, we can clear an alarm, okay, and we use those to then pass up alarm messages for what's going on. So for example, if you have an error or an e-stop or whatever, you want to pass that out to the HMI, the event logger is a good way of doing that rather than just triggering a flag or boolean logic and having to go and explore that. You could have it come up on the event logger list to see what's actually happened. Maybe something commanded a move that can't happen, or the IO network, field bus network died, or product was missing, or a robot cell failed, etc., etc. All these things can push as alarms, which can then be responded to by the machine user. So, thank you for listening to this. It's a really brief overview of the event logger. We've obviously looked at messages in the previous videos, and then going forward, we're going to actually start using the alarm side of things to actually do these alarms that we can create and then clear in response to signals from the PLC code itself. Thank you for listening, and see you next time.